Hi, everybody. This is the Windows 8.1 Developer Training Geek Edition. Welcome and thank you for joining us. My name is Pete Brown. I'm a developer evangelist at Microsoft and fellow geek, I think, here. And we're going to be talking about some really cool stuff here today. But I'd also like to introduce here my colleague, Jeff Berthoff. So, Jeff?
Yeah. Hi. Thanks for having me, Pete. Look forward to having fun with you today, talking about some of these geeky parts of Windows 8.1. So my name is Jeff Berthoff. I'm also an evangelist here at Microsoft, but I focus on HTML5. So I focus on web technologies, how we use JavaScript and HTML5 inside the apps and inside the browser.
So we're kind of counterparts here, where Jeff does the HTML side of things, I do the XAML side of things. But for the most part, I think, you know, we try to mix it up a little bit. And I think you know just enough XAML to be dangerous, and I know just enough HTML to work my way around like a WordPress site, I think.
Well, there you go. That's how you get started.
So we're going to be talking about some really cool things today. I mean, this is different from, I think, the normal developer training that we would do. So, you know, if you think about, you know, what we would normally talk about, I do a lot of business talks, a lot of talks about, hey, here's how to take a bunch of data and get it onto a form. But I like to use Windows for fun, right? So I do a lot of things in my off time that are unrelated to, say, like business application development. So I like to do stuff like, you know, I will design circuit boards, right? Or I will make music using things like the Surface Blade here, or mess around with, say, like, you know, robotic stuff like the Sphero here, which is, a really cool robotic cat toy, essentially. So what kind of stuff do you like to do for fun?
Well, when I'm not busy watching reruns of Brady Bunch or playing Minecraft with my kids, I tend to want to do kind of geeky things myself. So I always enjoy finding new environments where I can run JavaScript. I know it's what I do during the day, but at night it's kind of fun to explore new frontiers, new devices, and anything that I can get a Node.js server or JavaScript to run on, I'll tinker with that and make it work.
Right, so JavaScript during the day, JavaScript at
JavaScript
night,
in right? the yeah. day, JavaScript at night, yeah.
It's pretty cool. I have seen some microcontrollers even that run JavaScript and Node.js. So it's really come a long way in terms of what you can do with it.
Yeah, I think it takes about 4 hours between the time someone introduces a new device to the market and someone else gets JavaScript running on it. It's the window's closing.
It's pretty quick, right?
Yeah.
But today we're not going to be talking specifically about that stuff, but we do have some great talks on HTML and WebGL, which I think will be really exciting. Mm-hmm. We talk about the web app template, which is great for building Windows Store apps using web technologies. We'll do a little bit with speech and camera and microphones and things like that. And speaking of which, we have some webcam demos we're going to be working on. I've heard it gets really hot here later in the day. I'm currently wearing pants, so you know we'll have to see you later in the day if that works out for us. If for some reason that changes, I think we'll adjust the webcam demo a little bit and make sure that we're only getting things from the head up. But anyway, so just a word of caution for the folks that are watching at home, you may need to hide your kids. Now, we're also going to be talking about 3D printing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And in fact, we have over on the table over here some really cool devices. We have a 3D printer, we have race car, we have some Lego devices, Surface, all the types of things that we're going to be talking about today.
Yeah, and you know, these are all devices that work with Windows 8.1. These are all concepts that are introduced in Windows 8.1. Probably a lot of things that you didn't even know you could do on Windows, you can do today.
Cool. We'll also talk a bit later on today about Windows Embedded, and we'll do some point of service demos. So I brought some wonderful, little point of service stuff, which is, quite honestly, this is probably the least geeky thing that I've ever bought for as far as devices go. This is a barcode scanner. And I promised the guys here I wouldn't point the laser directly at the camera, but if I aim it maybe like right like that, and we'll see. If this show suddenly stops while we're doing that, you'll know what's going on. And then finally, at the end of today, we're going to wrap up by talking a little bit about performance. So, you know, all these things are really kind of cool, geeky things that, you know, are going to work into how to build apps in Windows 8.1 using all these technologies. But at the end, we also want to make sure we drive home some of the ideas around how to make apps that perform well and some of the things that you're going to do in XAML that will either make your app faster or slower, as well as some of the tools that we have in Visual Studio for diagnosing that. And so that'll also be towards the end of today. So it's a really full day, lots of stuff here. I also happen to have Twitter open here, so I will check that every once in a while. And we have a team of operators standing by monitoring all the rest of the stuff here to answer questions. And I can see one of them actively typing away over in the corner there answering your questions about this. So please feel free to ask us anything as we're going through here.
Yeah.
Okay. So just some expectations about, you know, what we expect you to have coming into this. This is a Microsoft Virtual Academy session, so it does have some training requirements. It's a little different than some of the things that Jeff and I have done before. The target audience for this, we expect that you have some Windows 8.1 experience building apps in either HTML or XAML. And there are some prerequisites that you may want to consider. They are available on the MVA site. There's also, you know, content elsewhere in MSDN. So, you know, most of the people that I know that are attending this have already experienced building apps there, so I'm fine with that. And certainly it would help if you're a geek. I think that would certainly be a decent prerequisite. The Microsoft Virtual Academy itself has you know, free online training. So this is, again, something a little different than some of the things Jeff and I have done before. Virtual Academy is arranged into courses, and apparently this is a course on how to be a geek using our stuff, so really cool things. It'll be interesting to see folks explaining that to their bosses later on in terms of what training they took for this year. And there's also a way that you can earn bonus points and do some other fun stuff. Send in all your bottle caps and you get free free MBA training. So, Jeff, I know some of the folks here who are attending probably aren't running Windows 8.1 yet, right? Mm-hmm. They may be running Windows 8, right? Or they may be running Windows 7, and they're just not familiar with some of the things that we have done in Windows 8.1. So Windows 8, when we released that, was really about you know, kind of getting the basics down for the new platform, for the new Windows Store stuff that we were producing, right? So really, it got all that out there. It had a lot of engineering behind it to get you know, the new form of apps, the new app model, the WinRT, a lot of work went into doing all that.
And with all the new hardware that was coming on the market at the time, that was a great opportunity for us to take Windows in a new direction. Touch is a big part of Windows 8.1 and Windows 8. So with Windows 8.1, they've taken some of those concepts that were introduced in Windows 8 and taken it a step further.
Yep. All right. So there's lots of great stuff in there. Now, what we did with Windows 8.1 is we've improved upon stuff that was in Windows 8. It's a free update. You know, anybody who's running Windows 8, we highly encourage you to update to that because most of what we're talking about today would not be possible without the enhancements made in Windows 8.1. Lots of new device APIs, lots of new user experience improvements, support for a lot of additional form factors and screen resolutions, et cetera. But it's still Windows 8. Like, all the apps that you build for Windows 8 will run on Windows 8.1. Right?
Right.
There's also, you know, a lot of personalization available in Windows 8.1. You can do some more things with the lock screens. There are new live tile sizes. Apps can share the screen, right, so that we now have this sort of sliced window model that you can have multiple apps on the screen at the same time. We kind of did away with, you know, we tried out the whole idea of having snapped apps in Windows 8. So we did that, found out a lot of people just found that that wasn't the most useful user experience for them. So we took that feedback in Windows 8.1 and made it so that you have multiple window sizes. And I know every time I use the mail app on my Surface and I go and I click on a link, I can immediately see that because I get the split screen and that just works, right? A lot more of integration with SkyDrive. And then there's a really new way of doing search. Search, I think, is another thing that you know, we had a way of doing it in Windows 8. The feedback that we got from customers is, you know, there were some discoverability issues with swiping in and hitting the search charm for searching apps. So we've made a real good system-wide search that lets you find apps, lets you find data on the web, and then we've encouraged people to put search on the app surfaces themselves, right? The new go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, and from a developer perspective, you may be wondering why all of these user features are something that you would be interested in. Well, when you think about it, every time there's a new feature for a user, you as a developer have to be able to code to that. So we want to make sure that you understand the platform so that you know what to take advantage of. If you haven't gotten Windows 8.1 yet, I will stop and take a moment. It's in the store.
So yes, we'll wait while you download it right now. Go ahead.
I don't know if we have that kind of time, but it might be a good idea to get it started in the background.
There you go.
It's pretty simple. If you're running Windows 8, you can go to the Windows Store and search for Windows 8.1, and the download's right there just like any other app. So you go and download it and install it.
Now, I will say, because I over Christmas break, I bought a lot of PCs. I swear that was my biggest gift to everybody, is I bought lots of PCs. Some of those still had Windows 8 on them. And before you can get the 8.1 upgrade to show up in the store, you need to make sure you apply all the updates, because one of those updates is what makes Windows 8.1 show up in the store. So if you're running Windows 8 and you look in the store and you don't see it, you might be a little behind on your updates. And if it's not a brand new PC that you just bought, then shame on you for being so behind on your updates. I think you need to update that once in a while. Okay. It's also a lot easier to discover and use apps in Windows 8. So the new Windows Store has been really optimized to make it much easier to discover apps that are relevant to you, as well as discover apps that are by the same publisher, discover what's trending, et cetera. This is all actually powered by Bing, which is really interesting. You see the whole search engine behind the store is powered by Bing. And then we have sort of a smart way of identifying apps that apply to you based upon the behavior of what you're doing in the store. So just like search engine on the web will recommend links based upon the types of things you normally search for, then same thing in the store, it'll recommend apps based on the kind of things you normally search for. In other words, don't ever look at Jeff's screen while he's searching, because who knows what kind of recommendations he'll get on the screen when he's doing that.
And for you developers, what this means for you is that it'll now be easier for users to find your apps. Yeah. So they're going to be able to discover the apps they're looking for a lot easier. And if they're looking for your app, it'll mean more downloads for you.
Yeah, exactly. And that's really what it's about. If you're building apps, then you want to maximize your downloads, either to increase your reputation, because not everybody needs to make money out of apps in the store.
Right.
You may be doing it for your reputation. And these types of fun apps that we're going to be talking about today can be really cool apps that you can put in the store and have on your resume, have on the types of things that you would show a prospective employer. Because I do know that we see employment applications all the time from people, and they will list open source projects they've contributed to, they will list apps that they've gotten in different app stores, and they'll list actual work that they've done in their day jobs. But a lot of times it's that open source contribution and it's those apps that they put in the store that really show you what a person is capable of.
Yeah, to be a developer, it doesn't mean that you have to do that all day long, every day. A lot of our development audience are hobbyists, are people who do it in their free time, do it for fun, or work on their own apps at night.
Yep. All right, so enough preamble, right? I think so. Everybody here now should know what Windows 8.1 is. Go out and start to download if you don't have it already on your machine. And if it's your work PC, don't worry. IT won't care if you update the operating system. So just go right ahead and make sure that you get that.
Tell them Pete sent you.
Yeah, it's all my fault. Just go ahead and give him my Twitter address or something there. And speaking of Twitter, you are at Boy of Green.
I'm right? At Boy of Green on Twitter.
And I am at Pete _ Brown, because somebody has been squatting on Pete Brown with no underscore for as long as Twitter has existed, and they never actually use it, but so _. So if you're developing apps for Windows 8.1, the first thing you need to be is you need to be on Windows 8.1.
Right.
Because the WinRT APIs that are available are only available on Windows 8.1. If you want to develop Windows 8 apps, you can develop them on Windows 8, right?
Right, and you could be using a virtual machine or something, but
you have
to be running the OS.
Yes. That way, that gets you access to all those APIs.
Right.
Now, one interesting thing that a lot of people don't really think about, especially .NET developers that have been developing apps for a long time, is the deployment model is such that you can count on the WinRT APIs just being on the machine, right? And if you are on Windows 8.1, they will have the Windows 8.1 WinRT APIs. There's no deployment of any kind of version of the .NET framework or anything that you need to worry about. It's all just there. So that's, I think, an extremely helpful thing for developers. You don't have to take on that burden. Now, if you want to design UI, I am not a great UI designer. I'm somewhat scary.
I've seen your aspect. Apps. I'll attest to that.
Yes. So, but you can, thank you very much. Blend for Visual Studio is really one of the best tools for building UIs. It comes free with Visual Studio. But most of the developers here are going to be doing a lot of their work inside Visual Studio itself.
Right.
I do encourage you, if you're doing anything with animations or if you're doing anything related to the UI, I encourage you to use Blend to kind of pretty that up a bit, because we do want beautiful apps in the store. One of the other nice things that we'll talk about towards the end of today that Visual Studio provides is tools for metering your apps. So I have a Surface over here. And we optimize things for battery life on a lot of these devices. And I want to know in my app, what is its impact on battery life? And there are tools now that if you're using Visual Studio, you can measure their CPU usage, you can measure network usage, especially important on metered networks, and you can also measure things like how much battery life is actually being used by your app, which is really nice. I mentioned a lot of updated APIs in Windows 8.1. Again, there are a lot of new ones and a lot of updated ones here. You know, there's a new version of WinJS, mm-hmm. right, which we'll talk about.
Yes, 2.0.
Yep. XAML has been updated with lots of new controls and lots of new capabilities there. We'll talk about each of those in a second. We have new versions of DirectX and Direct3D. We'll briefly discuss that later today. There are changes in the contracts. There are new services, new input mechanisms, and lots of changes in the device APIs, which will be the focus of a lot of this afternoon. So things like point of service, USB, Bluetooth, things that the phone has had for a bit, like Bluetooth. Mm-hmm. We now have recent versions of that that are actually really fast and well optimized here on Windows 8.1. So you can do a lot of things for connecting with these external devices. And I think something really exciting that you're going to be talking about with David here in a little bit is WebGL.
Right.
Which, I'm not an HTML developer, but WebGL is very exciting to me. So I think that would be a good
one. It is. It opens up new possibilities in the HTML5 and Java space or JavaScript space that we haven't had in the past. So.
Right. So let's, speaking of WebGL, let's talk a little bit about HTML and JavaScript.
Yeah. So to give you a little bit of background, in the past, HTML5 and JavaScript has been the language of the web, and that's what we've used to write web pages and deploy them on servers and load them up through browsers. But it's a very versatile set of languages. So a lot of people are familiar with them. A lot of people have been using them for years to build web apps and websites. So what Microsoft has done, starting with Windows 8, we've actually brought HTML and JavaScript into the app development environment to be a first-class programming language. What that means is that you can develop your store apps using HTML5 and JavaScript. So in Windows 8.1, we've taken that a step further and updated a lot of the components inside of that. So just briefly, we've updated the hosting environment, first of all. You might want to go back a slide there, yeah. So updated the hosting environment to use IE11. Mm-hmm. It's the new version of Internet Explorer that ships with Windows 8.1. So the app and development environment also uses IE11.
So when you say the hosting environment, you're talking about when you build an HTML JavaScript app for the Windows Store, it's actually being hosted inside a version of IE11? Is that what you're saying?
That's right. So it's technically not a version of IE11, but it uses the same rendering engine, the same JavaScript engine that IE11 uses. So in essence, however your pages render in IE11 are the same way they're going to render inside of the Windows 8.1 app.
Great.
So going to have the same great performance. It's going to have the same great support for HTML5 features. It'll just be as a store app instead of a web page. Along with the new app environment, we have new controls. We'll talk a little bit about WinJS 2.0 and some of the new features that it brings. But there's been a lot of controls that our developers have been asking for from Windows 8, and we brought that in Windows 8.1. And then we'll talk a little bit today about WebGL too, and what that means for not only developing for the web, but for developing HTML5 Windows Store apps as well. So here at Microsoft, we use HTML and JavaScript to build a lot of our core apps. And you see on the screen here a list of the Microsoft apps that are written using HTML5 and JavaScript. And you'll see some of the big ones too, like Skype, Mail, all of our Bing apps are written in HTML5 and JavaScript. So we've found it to be a very versatile platform for us to build a lot of different type of apps, and very powerful and feature-full apps as well.
I think one of the cool things about this is because we are building apps and dogfooding our own technology in here, some of our biggest customers using these technologies early on tends to be us, and it's a pretty short walk over to the product teams to ask for features to be added. So something like the Mail app here, I'm sure, is directly responsible for a number of the updates that are in WinJS 2.0.
That's right. Yeah, there's been a lot of things that in the control space and in the API space that our developers have kind of built on their own to have their app, perform certain functionality that we've seen it and said, hey, we need to pull that in and make that a standard component in the library. So what I want to do, Pete, is take a minute and actually demonstrate how you would work with an HTML5 app.
Okay.
So I'm going to bring open Visual Studio on my screen here. So if you are a developer in the Windows platform, this is going to look familiar to you. If you're a JavaScript developer and you're new to Windows, this might look a little foreign to you. What I'm going to do is I'm going to open up a new project. And you'll see the first thing I have is some choices as to the different languages that I'm going to use. So here, of course, I'm going to choose JavaScript. And I'm going to start out with just a blank app. But I'll note that we do have other options that you can use for your starter app. We have the Grid app, Split app, the Hub app, and new to Windows 8.1 is the Navigation app as well. But I'm going to open up a blank app. And the first thing that you're going to notice is on the screen is there is JavaScript. Over here, you'll see our files. We have HTML files, JavaScript files, and CSS files, the same thing that you would be familiar with if you're working on the web. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually just start by running this. And you'll see immediately in a Windows Store app, make a slight change here to the content. And again, this is just HTML.
So hello world, that was quite an original.
It is, it is. I thought of that myself. I spent a lot of time last night prepping. Okay, so as you can see, when I alter the HTML or the JavaScript, it immediately changes in the app. So this is a very familiar and comfortable environment for both Windows developers and for JavaScript developers who are used to working with HTML and JavaScript.
So I'm gonna. But it's dark. So like, is that something in Visual Studio? Like,
yeah, this
are you
is
just a hipster. And
this is a Visual Studio theme. I think I've grown used to looking at tools with dark backgrounds and light text. It's easier on the eyes when you spend so much time looking at the screen. At least for me.
I see. Okay.
What I'm going to do though is I'm actually going to start with a. Let's see here. With a web app that I have here, okay? This is a game, it's called Yeti Bowl, and the goal is to drop the snowballs, and I don't know if we have audio here or not, but there's some really great sound effects of hikers.
That was good, you got all three in one shot there.
Yeah, well, I've been playing this for a while. So Yeti Bowl is this fun little web app, and it runs on a website. You can use it in any browser. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the code base for this, and I'm going to drop it right into Visual Studio. So the idea is that here, I want you to understand that this is the same code running on the web. Do I need to stop it?
Jeff's just learning how to do drag and drop, folks.
I am, yeah, sorry. The same code that runs on the web is going to run inside of the store app as well. So I've dumped my code in there. I'm going to open up my manifest and change the start page from default to my game page.
Now, did you have to do, so like what was in this project to begin with to make that happen? Like, so you created a Windows Store app.
Yeah, so this was the blank web app, or excuse me, the blank Windows Store app that we had opened up.
Right, and so then I just blank Windows Store app.
Blank Windows Store app. And then I had all of the code that I had for running the game here. So CSS files, JavaScript files, images. Right now, I just drag and dropped it into my Solution Explorer, which added it all to this project. So once it was added, I then changed the starter page from default to game. And now when I run it, that same web app is now a Windows Store app. And it's going to inherit all the same features that you would have from any Windows Store app.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now that doesn't have like some of the other things that like there's no say like charms integration or an app bar or nav bar or anything like that, right? That comes from the stuff you're going to talk about later today.
Right. And the great thing about that is I start with this same app, but inside the Windows environment, I can build on top of that. I can then add in charm integration. I can add in live tiles. The things that will make the app stand out on the Windows platform rather than just being a website are things that I can add on top of it inside the app environment. So it's very easy. If you're familiar with JavaScript, if you're familiar with Windows apps, one or the other, put them together and you have this real easy environment for developers.
Cool. And it says, oh, noes, so I know it's cool.
Yes, that's right.
Very cool. So I think the idea here is that if you are, you know, we're not trying to convince people to build apps in HTML and JavaScript necessarily, but it sounds like we're saying if you're an HTML and JavaScript developer, that this could be a comfortable environment for you to be able to build apps in for Windows.
So as a web developer, one of the things that I really enjoy about writing for Windows is they don't actually tell me what language I have to use to write apps. I can use the language that I'm comfortable with. And in my case, that's JavaScript and HTML. So I'm able to use my skills to write apps on the platform. All I have to do is learn those integration points, learn the new Windows APIs, kind of the cool and interesting parts that make it a Windows app rather than just a web app.
Cool. So speaking of what you're comfortable with, mm-hmm. I have been a C-sharp developer for as long as C-sharp was out. You know, as a Visual Basic developer long before that. I know, like I said, just enough JavaScript to get myself into lots of trouble and, you know, add comment forms on websites and stuff. Seriously, I don't know a lot of JavaScript. But I do know some C++, and I do know a lot of C-sharp. So one of the nice things in Windows 8.1 and even in Windows 8 is that you can use C-sharp or Visual Basic, and there are a few Visual Basic developers on the line here, I know, or C++, which is something that's new. You can use any of those with XAML because XAML is something that is very similar to what we have with Silverlight, but because it's implemented as something native in WinRT, C++ developers are now able to take advantage of that. And so I think that's really a cool thing, because I know C++ folks have been asking for something above and beyond MFC for a really long time. So, you know, being able to build those apps in any of those languages is great, and have the same level of access to all across all of those, I think, is a really good idea. But the idea here is if you are a .NET developer, or you are a XAML developer, you know, WPF, Silverlight, whatever, or also a Windows Phone developer, because most of those apps are XAML and C#. If you know any of those things, then it'll be much easier for you to learn to build Windows Store apps using XAML and C# here. Now, I mentioned that the XAML stack is native in as part of the Windows runtime. It's always present. Because it is native, it's very fast. It's been optimized for speed. You know, I know that some of the WPF developers out there have told me that, hey, there are parts of the WPF XAML stack that could be faster. You know, the teams have taken that information into account and made sure that the XAML stack that you see in Windows 8.1 is as fast as can be, and they're constantly tweaking it to make it even faster on low-power devices, which is interesting because I think for a long time, we had just been building apps that were bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and had access to more memory and had the ability to, you know, just sort of really take over the whole system. But now we're starting to get devices that are much lower power. Like you're starting to have to go back to building for like ARM processors or low power Intel devices and stuff. So we have to step back for a second and start being efficient about how we code again, right?
Right. And I think that the Windows Group has kind of led the way, and the system requirements for Windows 8.1 is even lower than it is for Windows 8, and Windows 8 was lower than it was for Windows 7.
Yeah. So it's interesting that we keep actually lowering the bar for building, you know, for hardware for Windows itself. And like I use my Surface all the time. This is a Surface 2 here, and it is very fast and I can't believe I'm going to say fast and fluid, but I will say it anyway, as far as animations and stuff go. And that's only because people have put a lot of time and thought into performance on there. So.
Right.
Again, towards the end of today, we're going to talk about some specific performance things that you want to keep in mind, because I can't emphasize enough that you can build a slow app in HTML, you can build a slow app in XAML, but we have at the same time tried to provide tools and technologies that make it much easier for you to build a fast and efficient app using those technologies. So again, so we put some really large investments in XAML and .NET and Windows 8.1. You are still using .NET when you build a XAML app, so there's the WinRT side, right, which is all of the common stuff that you have as part of the operating system. It's sort of the new Win32. You can kind of think of it that way, right? And then there's a subset of .NET, which is available for building Windows Store apps. This is very similar to if you're building a WinJS app, you have here's WinRT stuff, and then here are all the other libraries that you might use alongside WinRT, right?
And we'll talk a lot more about that in the next session, but Microsoft provides you some great libraries for building the Windows Store apps, but if you're already using an open source library or any library for that fact, In your JavaScript apps, bring that along with you. Bring that code that you've already written in the libraries that you're already familiar with.
Yeah. So as a .NET developer, you can still use a lot of the same approaches that you've used before, being able to do binary sharing of components. So you can create a portable class library, and you can use that across your different .NET apps in Windows. At the same time, you can create WinRT components in C Sharp, Visual Basic, or C++, and be able to use those not only from other .NET and XAML apps in the store, but also from even HTML and JavaScript apps. So you can create a Windows component that does something useful that, say, as a business, you want something that's going to be shared across these different languages, and be able to consume that from JavaScript as well.
Right.
So very cool. And that's something that you can also share with Windows Phone and share with other technologies as well. You do have full access to the native XAML stack from C++, including integration with DirectX. We have some interesting things about that in a couple of seconds here. Of course, it's a modern declarative UI. Some folks like Jeff might argue that HTML is also a modern declarative UI, but we'll disagree about that. XAML is cooler. And then it's the same API regardless of which language that you're using it in. Now, Jeff had pointed out a lot of the cool apps that are built on HTML and JavaScript in Windows. I'd also like to point out some really cool apps that are built on XAML in Windows. Now, the majority of these are XAML and C++, although there is, I believe, some C# and some of this stuff here. But apps like the camera, right, and SkyDrive, and the alarms, and the photo apps, and Fresh Paint, and OneNote, and other stuff there, Link even, are all built using our own technologies. So just like we were the biggest dog fooders for HTML and JavaScript, we're also the biggest dog fooders for XAML and .NET and C++.
Yes, and I suppose I would concede that HTML isn't always the best language for writing an app. So one of the great things about Windows 8.1 is that you can choose the language that's most appropriate for the type of app that you're writing for.
Yeah.
So in some of these cases, whenever you're building games or things like the camera app, C++ might be the way to go, or C# might be a better result. And you have that ability to make the choice in Windows 8.1.
Yeah, and if I drop dead from a heart attack here in a second, it's because I just got Jeff to admit that HTML wasn't what you use for everything.
Well, I can think of one or two examples. Let's put it that way.
There might be one or two things where maybe it's not the best thing to use. Okay, yeah, I might think of a couple as well. So other interesting things here is the XAML, the way the architecture is for XAML is it's not just the stuff that sits on top that we as developers always use, but there are also underlying core technologies that support XAML. And a lot of those core technologies are being used, like a lot of the rendering pipeline and stuff, are being used even in our core experiences in Windows. There are a lot of the sort of innards of what makes Windows 8.1 fast and what makes the UI very, fluid and stuff are also built on those same technologies. And there are also core experiences that aren't apps that are built on XAML, like search and contact cards. If you're running 8.1 on something like a Surface or another device with a camera and you're on the lock screen, you can swipe up, I believe it is, or swipe down to get to the camera. That experience as well is also built on XAML. So again, the point here is not necessarily a contest between HTML and JavaScript, because we know which one would win, but it's really about showing that we use the same technologies that you use in building apps. We're using those to build apps and using those to build the operating system. And it wasn't always that case. It is something that I think really helps make the platform better when we do that.
It is.
So I'm going to be doing a lot of XAML demos throughout the rest of the day, but what I would like to do here is a quick demo of sort of Hello World. I don't have anything as interestingly named as Yeti Bowl, which sounds like something you might get at a party. I don't know. It's like sort of some strange thing there. I don't have anything like that, but what I am going to do here is just quickly create a new project. I'm going to use C#. And there are a couple of different templates here, just like what Jeff showed in HTML and JavaScript. And what's interesting is we've tried to make sure that there's really good parity here between the templates that you get in C++, the templates that you get in HTML, the templates that you get in C# and Visual Basic here. So I could do a split app. We don't have a navigation app because these all have kind of navigation built in, but we do have blank app, grid app, etc. just like you did, I'm going to create a blank app. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to drag a website in here, but I am going to do, I think, the same hello world that you had.
Well, you know, Pete, we will be talking a little bit later about the web view. So all you XAML developers who do want to use websites in your apps, you can do that.
That's right. So just like, you know, if you're a frustrated HTML and JavaScript developer and really want to do some C Sharp, you can create a WinRT component.
Sure, I've never met one, but, you know, for the sake of conversation.
Yeah, and if you're a frustrated XAML developer who really wants to use HTML and JavaScript, you can incorporate that with the web view.
That's right.
Excellent. So, you know, it's kind of really nice integration with that. And what's interesting there is that's not something that we're always able to do, right? If you tried to do web technology in, say, like a WPF app, there were what called airspace issues, where because the way you're overlaying a window on top of the content, there were questions about the XAML didn't overlay the stuff properly and everything. So everything now is just fully integrated and comes down to the same rendering surface.
And when we talk about using the right language for the right type of application, you may have needs for multiple languages inside the same app. And so we have mechanisms to make that work.
Yep. All right, so I'm just going to quickly here. Now, I can use the design surface, and I can drag and drop controls on here. I believe you can do the same thing in the HTML designer. But instead, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to type in some XAML. And what I really like here is there's really good IntelliSense inside the IDE. And I think also the IntelliSense for JavaScript and stuff has come a long way as well.
Yes.
Right, so especially if you spell things correctly. If I type text block here, right, I say text equals. Now, if I wanted to bind, we now have binding IntelliSense, right? But I don't have anything that I'm necessarily going to be binding to here. But if I did have, say, like a data context that I could specify in XAML that was available at this point in time, I could bind to that and be able to specify, say, like the person's last name or something. So we do have strong IntelliSense there. We showed a bit of that off in the keynote, day two keynote at Build. So when Steve Guggenheimer was up there, he was talking a bit about those features. So I'm not going to do binding here. I think most folks, if you're not familiar with binding, there are some great examples, both, again, in HTML and JavaScript, as well as in C-sharp and XAML here, available through the MBA site, as well as on MSDN. Mm-hmm. But I'm just going to say, hello, world, right? And that's really tiny, so I'm going to create increase the font size. I can say font size equals 50, makes it a little bit larger. I want to make this an excited hello, world, not just hello, world, but excited hello, world, so there we go, right? There are lots of new properties on these different controls. So, for example, if I wanted to have, let's say, a stack panel here, so I can have more than one thing, let's say stack panel, and then move my text block into that. Stack panel will lay things out just one on top of the other. And then if I say I have a text box, text equals hello, Jeff. So now we're getting more specific here. There is also world's widest text box. So let's say width equals 200. All right. So that says, hello, Jeff. Let me do the font size. Font size equals 50 again. If I wanted to have a label for that, and of course, I need to make the width bigger. So let's see. 3. Hello, Jeff. Okay. There we go. So there are new features such as labels that you'll see on a lot of these controls. So if I go, if I get here, header. That's what it was. I call them labels, but it's a header. The reason it's a header is because you can put anything in it that you want. It's a content control inside XAML. It doesn't have to be text. It could be images or anything like that. For the header here, it can say something like HTML noob. Hello, Jeff. There you go. So the header on that just says HTML noob, right? And then we have hello, Jeff there. Now, we also have support inside the text box for multicolor fonts. So if you've ever sent like smileys or anything like that, most of the web browsers and stuff do this by default, but if you've sent smileys, the actual glyph for a smiley is a multicolor graphic, right? It's like a yellow face and different color mouth and stuff. So we have support for those and setting the caret color in text box as well, or text boxes as well. Lots of new features for that stuff. We also have some performance-related features for large lists, which we'll talk about towards the end of today as well. So let me just quickly run this Hello World app. It's going to run on a machine. You see there are some performance counters up on the top left and top right, and both those are enabled by default. They let you see the frame rate and how you're doing. And then there's my giant X to clear that out. And actually, I'm the HTML noob between us, so I'll be a little more fair there, right? So let me switch over to this and stop. If, again, we're not going to go in depth on the basics of any of these languages here. I know you'll do a bit more in the HTML session.
Yes.
But if you're not familiar with XAML, then definitely go and attend some of the other MBA stuff. I also know somebody who has a really cool book on building Windows 8 apps in XAML. So if you're interested in that, I would highly encourage you to support my hobbies and family and buy that book, right? So let me just quickly run back to the slides here, because I want to talk a bit about how to build apps in C++ and DirectX. Now, I'm not going to actually do this here today. It's know your limits, man, right?
Right?
So I know my limits. So I'm not going to try to build this here today. But it's really interesting to think about combining HTML, combining DirectX with C++ and XAML for lots of different types of apps, right? So you know, C++ and DirectX are really what we would recommend if you need the highest performance. And you know, you're talking, you're really looking at each and every frame that you're working with, and you need to make sure that you get the most out of that. So DirectX provides the graphics functionality for Windows. You know, everything ultimately renders down to DirectX, but sometimes you need to be able to access that API directly. It's very high performance, and it is the lowest level graphics API for applications. It is, if you're thinking about coding graphics on the metal, this is the technology that you want to use. So it also provides, you know, access to building games. We're going to talk about, you know, WebGL, which is slightly different. Still renders down to DirectX ultimately in this case. But you can build apps directly using DirectX. Is that too many directs? directly using DirectX. C++ and DirectX. So DirectX 11.2 is part of Windows 8.1, and it does have very high performance interop with XAML. So you know, think about what I said earlier about WPF, where if you had a DirectX window and you wanted to have a menu that showed up, it could never overlap that DirectX window because the way the windowing layer was. It was actually two separate HWINs in Windows. So we have Windows, directly Windows HWINs wins, right? So in Windows, so they didn't want to overlap properly. So your menu would actually disappear behind that. And that happened also if you tried to integrate Silverlight or the browser inside WPF apps. So in Windows Store apps, there are no airspace issues. If you want to integrate DirectX, you can do that and have XAML overlap it. If you want, you could have pretty much any kind of content in there overlapping with that and have them all behave together properly. Because again, same rendering layer. We do have a lot of new tooling for DirectX. There are some build videos that I would encourage people to watch, which talk about being able to go into the debugger and find out where exactly a pixel came from. Like being able to point to a pixel and figure out what line of code created that pixel, which I think is really great. So XAML is, I said, the first UI platform that includes this integration. So I'm very encouraged by that. I think this is something that game developers and folks have been asking for a long time. If you want to create UI and controls inside this technology, you're probably going to get furthest by creating stuff in XAML. You can do it in DirectX. People have for years, but it was painful because each of the states for the controls becomes a different bitmap and stuff. You have to draw those and manage all that state manually, and you're dealing with a frame-based rendering system as opposed to an event-based system. So that was always pretty challenging. If you want to use custom graphics, if you want to do image editing, create games, doing that directly on the DirectX surface is good. And then, again, no airspace issues there. Oh, and that was a cool, okay. Ooh, check that out, folks. I don't know if that came through, but woohoo. I'm just gonna do that all day, sorry. For a second, I thought I switched apps for a second. So here's an example, this is OneNote, right? So you can always tell when I crib somebody else's slide because the transitions are different because I didn't check on it. So what OneNote is it's a XAML and DirectX app. The design surface in OneNote is all DirectX. So all the stuff that you're doing over there when you're laying stuff out is all DirectX. But then all of the menus and that little overlay radial menu and stuff, that is all built in XAML.
And again, there's no need to spend the time to build all those menus out in C++ when XAML just works better, works quicker.
Yeah, I mean, you're still doing it in C++.
Right.
But you're using the declarative UI as opposed to marking it up in and using DirectX type stuff. Like you don't have to create a pixel shader to do your menu anymore. So this is a game, typically you would think of a game as being all DirectX, But if you want to use some of the built-in Windows functionality, you want to have, let's say, like app bars or something like that, or you know, the opening menu screens where you have to pick through a list of things, you can do that all in XAML. You can make it look as pretty as you want, but it'll be much more efficient for you to do it in XAML. So in this one, the whole gameplay area is DirectX, but you know, the app bars and navigation bars and all those things are all built in XAML, so you get automatically the built-in functionality of being able to use the mouse to right-click and have the stuff pop down, or you know, any of the other behaviors that, that come along with that. So again, it cuts down on the amount of work that DirectX developers need to do. And I think this was the last cool transition of the whole bunch here. But this is Fresh Paint, which is a very cool app. It's actually, it is a first-party app. It's a very cool painting app for, you know, it has templates that you can color stuff in if you want. And it also has, you know, you can import photos. You can just sort of draw on it with your fingers. Oh, for a second, I was going to draw on this, but this isn't the actual app. And what this is also is a combination of DirectX and XAML, excuse me. But what's interesting here is it's multiple layers. So we have DirectX is the whole surface that you're going to be drawing on. But because they already had to figure out how to render the brush strokes and stuff in DirectX, when you want to see the preview and the paint mixing palette and stuff up there at the top, that's also DirectX, whereas all the other Chrome elements that you see here are XAML. Right, so again, it can get pretty complex. You can have, you know, XAML on top of DirectX, and then you can have DirectX back on top of that afterwards. You know, obviously, the more of this you do, the more of a performance impact there is. But we've made it so that you can go pretty far without, you know, hitting any kind of real negative performance impact at this point. And I use this app on my Surface as well. So it runs perfectly well on ARM. So, you know, when you're thinking about DirectX on top of XAML and stuff on ARM, then you know that has to work pretty well. So it showed you on the table earlier a little bit of some of the toys that we're going to be playing with. Can we get one last beauty shot of that before we wrap this up here today? So, yeah, we have cars.
Printers, cars, devices.
That car looks like a shoe from
it
here.
It does.
it's a moving slipper. But we have, you know, you'll see some PCBs back there. We'll talk a little bit about Windows Embedded. You know, shout out to Eric Haver, did some Lego models. He stayed up all last night working on some Lego stuff for us, which actually sounds really funny. It's like my coworker stayed up all night using Lego. It's like, do I applaud that or okay?
Should you be worried, right?
Yes, it's really hard to explain to your boss that that was the work. Like, what did you do last night? I pulled an all nighter with Lego.
These aren't your average Legos though.
Yes, you're right. There's some pretty serious stuff. We'll talk about Bluetooth, right? I have a couple of demos here. Actually, the car that's over there is a Bluetooth car. I also have the Sphero. Guarantee at least one of these things is not going to work.
At least one.
At least one, because these are all sort of like strange connectivity, but we'll see. I mentioned also the barcode scanner and lasers and stuff like that, right? So, you know, I used to have a barcode on the back of my neck from working here, but I've gotten that tattoo removed. But you can, you know, zap stuff with barcodes. We'll talk about that. That's actually sort of a businessy type thing, unless you're thinking about running a mini Walmart out of your house is sort of your hobby. I don't know. And we're also going to talk about WebGL and HTML and web app template.
That's right.
In fact, that's one of the things that's coming up next, right?
Yep.
So cool. So thank you, everybody. I'm looking forward to seeing you all for the rest of today. We have lots of really exciting stuff coming up. The majority of today, I think, is going to be demo-oriented. We just wanted to make sure you had the grounding in what Windows 8.1 is and what the different technologies are. But the majority of what you see the rest of today is going to be a bunch of geeks poring over code and poring over devices. So looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you.